Well, moving ahead for the next session, may I please invite our moderator, Dr. Samiksha Tedepalli, our conveyor, Dr. Marian Pauli, our chairman, Dr. Anita Sethi, and our co-chairman, Dr. Mithil Raman, for this session. Over to the moderator.
Good afternoon to everyone present here. So our eyelids often confer more beauty than the eyes themselves. And the abnormalities can be quite bothersome, both aesthetically and functionally. So without much ado, I would welcome you all to the second session of today, Eyelids as the Window to the World. We are joined by Chairperson Dr. Anita Sethi, Senior Consultant of Fortis Medical Research Center in Gurugram, Dr. Rapan Mittal from iPlast Eye Plastic Surgery Center in Amritsar, our convener, Dr. Marian Pauli from Girdhar Eye Institute, Cochin, and we have our esteemed speakers who are joining us. I would like Dr. Anita ma'am to say a few words before we start off.
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. This seems to be a very exciting session we're looking forward to. And I would just like to say, you know, it'll be good if all the speakers stick to the time so that we can have more discussion. It's always more interesting when we can see other people's points of view. So let's stick to the time. All the questions can be raised in the chat box to Dr. Samiksha or Dr. Marian. And then we will see, we will try to answer one or two questions per speaker. And then we hope we have some time at the end to have a good discussion. So over to you, Samiksha. Start with the first speaker.
So we're going to switch up the order a little. It's my great honor to invite Dr. Ashok Grover, sir, for the first talk. He will be taking us through his view on the evaluation and decision-making in terms of scrutiny eyelids. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Samiksha. It's a privilege to be a part of this session. And chairpersons, Anita, thank you. Thank you to the scientific committee and Fairuz for this opportunity to be in this session. And we've had a wonderful start meeting everybody with the wonderful lacrimal session. So I'll be starting about the importance of evaluation and decision-making for the ptotic eyes. As we know, decision-making in a diverse condition like congenital ptosis can be difficult, and a good evaluation is critical to it. The congenital ptosis has many variants, and acquired ptosis has many, many more variations. So an evaluation, like anywhere else, begins with a good history taking, followed by examination. The evaluation, the history taking, helps us to differentiate the congenital from an acquired condition. It helps us look for any predisposing factors, any variability, any previous surgical procedures, and a possible family history as a contributory factor. Examination should never forget the general examination, which would hold a clue in a number of conditions, especially those with systemic associations, such as pharyngeal, oculopharyngeal dystrophy, a CPEO, myasthenia, or several other conditions. And same is true for a neurological examination in particular. But having stressed the importance of these, we'll proceed to the ophthalmic examination. Like elsewhere, visual acuity and association of refractive errors is crucial. And we know the specific associations of astigmatic error and amblyopia with ptosis, especially congenital ptosis, which may occlude pupil or cause refractive errors. Pupillary examination is important both in congenital and in acquired conditions where the etiology may be linked, such as a third nerve palsy, a Horner syndrome, and many other conditions. One of the usual helpful signs in differentiating a congenital from acquired is the effect of dystrophy in causing a poor relaxation, causing the eye to look larger in a congenital ptosis than in an acquired ptosis. External examination can be contributory, where mechanical ptosis may be due to an associated lid mass or any other pathology, either conjunctival or the eyelid. But a congenital ptosis or an acquired ptosis must be quantified. And this begins with a measurement of the palpebral aperture. Both the vertical and the horizontal must be assessed. Vertical is particularly important, and the scale, a transparent scale, is a crucial implement for this. So measurement of margin reflex distance, which is the distance from the reflex to the center of the eyelid, is a very useful measure for comparison and for assessment of the amount of ptosis. So we can gather the amount of ptosis either by comparison with normal values or by comparison with the other eye, which helps us grade the ptosis into mild, moderate, and severe. Ocular motility assessment is very important, as we'll see that there are a number of associations both with congenital and acquired ptosis. Levator action is probably one of the most important things which helps us determine the nature of surgical procedure. So the excursion from down to up gaze while the frontalis action is blocked is a critical measurement, which again helps us quantify or classify the levator action. Measurement of the margin crease distance in the downward gaze is again useful, as it helps as a standard for preparing the incision on the ptotic side. Both sides must be measured. But a tarsal platform show, or the amount of the distance for, or the principal lid crease from the center of the eyelid, is important in decision making and in diagnosis. But Herring's law must never be forgotten. As an example, a ptotic eye may droop further when the more ptotic eye is lifted, as you can see here. So Herring's law must be kept in mind when making decisions regarding the management. Presence of Bell's phenomenon is again critical for protection, and so is corneal sensation when the lag of thalmos in the post-operative period may be present. Phenylephrine test is particularly crucial where we assess the elevation with phenylephrine in those cases where we are considering a Müller's muscle procedure. We must look at all the possible associations as well, and we are all aware of the associations. Jaw winking ptosis in our center constitutes almost 1/6 of the cases. And you must, besides severity of ptosis, assess the excursion of jaw winking and the associated motility problems, which are present in up to 50% of the cases of jaw winking. Blepharophimosis syndrome, again, a familial condition, autosomal dominant transmission with its characteristic features, needs to be diagnosed and managed. Ocular motility disorders, an important condition that is to be kept in mind is this. So an apparent drooping here, which gets corrected on covering the other eye. So this constitutes the pseudoptosis, which must be kept in mind and differentiated from a true ptosis with ocular motility defect association. And a condition like this can be corrected just by squint surgery, so that the ptosis disappears without any ptosis surgery. The other associations in congenital or acquired need to be looked at. The commonest are superior rectus underaction and the monoocular elevation defect, which are present because of development of the superior rectus from the same myotome as the levator palpebrae superioris. A congenital third now palsy, presence of horizontal deviation, or a CFOM, congenital fibrosis syndrome, are other important associations. Amongst the acquired disorders, you need to take into consideration the presence of chronic progressive external ophthalmoplegia and myasthenia gravis as some of the most common associations. But other muscular dystrophies and third nerve palsy may be important causes of ptosis. we need to look at the entire array, and we'll go through some typical examples: pseudotosis, involutional, neurogenic, myogenic, traumatic, and mechanical, where appropriate evaluation will be critical. So CPEO, with its classical features, is usually easy to diagnose and can be managed appropriately with conservative sling procedures. Suspected myasthenia, the ophthalmic tests available help us make the diagnosis, although contribution from RNST and the serum tests, again, is very useful. So this is an illustration of an 18-year-old male presenting with no history of diurnal variation, but an eye test gave us the diagnosis within 5 minutes. This is another patient with restricted motility in all directions, asymmetric ptosis, corrected after neostigmine injection. But aponeurotic ptosis is possibly the most commonly seen acquired ptosis, and a moderate to severe ptosis with very good retained levator action and a distant lid crease. Apparent thinning above the tarsal plate, which can be felt, is again a very important clue. And levator aponeurosis, a detachment, or at times a Müller's muscle resection procedure help correct this condition well. We see these cases in India in the young as well, and reattachment of dehisced aponeurosis serves the purpose very well. Amongst the myogenic cases, there may be an association like this, where we had a normal pupils, restriction of motility in several gazes, and we found the association with myositis. So a myositis associated with involvement of the levator complex would lead to a myositic non-specific orbital inflammatory disease will be the diagnosis, which can be corrected by your therapeutic measures such as steroid. Neurogenic ptosis may present like this, and like in this elderly man, that there was complete ptosis, restricted motility, and no perception of light. So here we could find the cause as a metastatic carcinoma tongue at the orbital apex. Traumatic ptosis again needs to be assessed and corrected appropriately. Mechanical ptosis, such as in a neurofibromatosis case here, again is tackled as removal of that mass. Now, decision making in congenital ptosis is this regarding the appropriate age for surgery and the appropriate choice of surgical procedure. In most cases, we operate at more than 3 years of age, whereas for fascia lata sling surgery, where autologous fascia is to be harvested, the age is 4 years, except if pupil is covered, when a procedure may be done in early infancy. Of course, there are studies in blepharophimosis syndrome and other conditions that even if pupil is partially covered, there may be ptosis and they need to be done early. So decision is based on all the factors that we spoke about earlier. Amount of ptosis, levator action are most critical, which help us choose between a fascinella levator or a frontalis sling surgeon. So ocular motility disorders, wherever present, must be tackled first. In acquired ptosis, basically the etiology is based on management of the cause and then management of the ptosis. So appropriate correction of the cause helps in taking care of the acquired ptosis, as in an acquired aponeurotic ptosis. Thank you very much. Hope the subject is at least reasonably covered. Thank you.
Thank you so much, doctor. We are glad that you finished it on time. Over to the moderator.
It was very extensive and the photographs really helped in the understanding much better. So I would like to ask for your input on how you deal with Marcus Gunn phenomenon, since you said 1/6 of your patients do have it. So how do you normally approach them?
I think that's possibly because of the referral bias, because I've been doing jaw winking for a long time. I think the basic things that you need to decide are the extent of ptosis and the extent of excursion. If the excursion of jaw inking is only about 2 millimeters, at times you can just correct the ptosis, possibly by a Fasanella servet or a levator procedure, whatever is appropriate, and let that jaw inking be. There are those who do have jaw inking without any ptosis either, but usually they have mild jaw inking and they can be left alone. Those with a significant excursion, it is important to take care of removal of that excursion and levator disabling by a complete excision, including the horns, is the way to do that. And that must be corrected. The ptosis that you create is best corrected by a sling procedure, a frontalis sling procedure. You can do a sialastic sling procedure unilaterally, but the disadvantage is the asymmetry in down gaze, and that is best corrected if you do a bilateral levator excision with bilateral fascia aletta sling, which allows a perfect symmetry to be achieved in those who are willing for it.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Bova. And that's the question actually I wanted to ask you, because a lot of us find it very difficult to convince the patients with unilateral ptosis to go in for a bilateral surgery. But I agree with you, the overall cosmetic result is much better in a bilateral. And I think if we believe in it, what do you say? So how do you convince your patients to go in for bilateral?
So as I said earlier, it's the conviction of the surgeon which matters. So once you are convinced that you're doing the best for the child and for the patient, then you are very easily able to convince the parents. It's because you say it as a matter of fact thing. In fact, when I am reluctant at times and I advise a unilateral procedure, because maybe I have a long list, unfortunately, many of the parents have heard about the bilateral procedure. And that's why they have come to me and they insist on a bilateral procedure. So it works both ways at times.
I guess, as Dr. Grover said, it's basically a surgeon's conviction. Somehow I could not ever gather that courage of doing a bilateral surgery for MGP correction. So in my cases, I generally tend to make the patient or the attendants understand that after improving the ptosis, the excursion will decrease. So anyway, the Marcus gun phenomena would decrease and it would not be so, you know, bothering to the patient as it was earlier. But definitely with Dr. Grover's experience, I guess we need to learn how we get convinced ourselves as well in times to come.
Thank you, Raman.
Thank you so much, sir. I would now like to call upon our next speaker, Dr. Joyita Das, who's joining us from Dishai Hospital in Barakpur. She will be taking us through some periocular trauma advanced puzzles.
My slides are visible?
Yes, Dr. Joyita.
Yes, Joyita, your slides are visible. Okay. Continue. Okay.
Make it full screen.
Thank you for the invitation, AIUS ARC, especially Dr. Fairuz, for the kind invitation. Such a nice program you have made. I'll be talking on periocular trauma, the advanced puzzle. I have no financial interest, and informed consent for the presentation, photograph presentation has been taken from the patient. Injuries to the periocular region are often complex and involve multiple anatomic structures. To avoid post-traumatic functional and cosmetic sequelae, reconstructive expertise is required. Optimal aesthetic and functional outcome can be achieved through meticulous planning and knowledge of facial reconstructive technique. In periocular trauma, the structure which are affected are eyelid, both anterior and the posterior lamella, the lacrimal system, and the bony orbit. So the periocular trauma can be simply classified as eyelid trauma, lacrimal injury, and orbital fracture. The eyelid laceration again can be classified according to the location as non-marginal, marginal, medial and lateral canthal tear and canaliculi tear. The non-marginal tear again can be classified as superficial, where there is the skin and the part of the orbicularis is affected, and deep, as in this case, there is the depth of cut injury is almost up to the bony orbital rim. This is how the marginal tear looks, where the margin is affected. And according to the defect made in the lid, this can be classified as mild, moderate, severe, that is less than 25%, 25 to 50%, and more than 50%. This is how these canthal tears look. It could be both medial canthal tear, or it could be both medial and lateral canthal tear. In both blunt and penetrating trauma, both in both the condition, it can be present. Next is canaliculi tear. It is more common in children and young adult. This canaliculi area, actually the area of dehiscence, so it is very common in all kind of blunt trauma and even penetrating trauma. Upper lower canaliculi is more vulnerable to tear than the upper canaliculi. So the goal of eyelid repair is to re-establish the anatomical configuration, to restore the physiological function, to provide a better cosmetic appearance. We will have a step-by-step approach of lid repair. First, we have to evaluate the lid tear, have to take the history of timing, mechanism, and the location. We should ask the same question, like, was the object is blunt or it is a sharp, whether it constitutes organic or a non-organic metallic object or not. And if it is removed, is it removed in the whole or in pieces? Next, you have to see the stability of the patient. First, you have to check the airway, breathing, and circulation. Have to stable the patient first, then do the complete examination. First, vision and globe perforation has to be checked, and we have to check for the muscle entrapment. Associated injury like palpation of the orbital rim and other facial bone for possible fracture. In imaging, any orbital trauma, first CT scan of the orbit and the brain is the first choice of in the imaging of choice, in especially in penetrating trauma, in retained foreign body, if you are suspecting some retained foreign body, and in severe blunt trauma to evaluate the concurrent fracture and other in intracranial injury. And we should get an image, at least image before the laceration repair. And the next step is wound inspection, cleaning, and documentation. This documentation is very, very important for to avoid future medico-legal issues. Then assessment of the lacrimal system, look for the canaliculi and look for the telecanthus. Next is anesthesia point. Repair should be done under GA in case of children, in an adult with an extensive tear, and if there is associated bone fracture and associated globe repair, and rest of the repair can be repaired by under local anesthesia. The protocol of suturing, I'll tell, first repair the deep tissue first, and we should use 6-0 polyglactin or vicryl suture in repairing periocular tissue. But when we are planning for repairing the lateral canthal tendon, 5-0 vicryl or proline is the suture of choice. If orbital septum is affected, we should not suture the orbital septum, otherwise it may lead to retraction later on. And when there is extensive tissue loss and some necrotic tissue or infected tissue is there, it should be left alone without suture, and regular dressing and antibiotic will do secondary repair by secondary intention or laces fear. This is a case showing upper lid septum tear. You can see the fat prolapse is there. So the fat is taken back and the skin suture is done, and this is the post op picture after 2 weeks. Here is a short video of full thickness marginal tear repair. First, 6-0 silk suture has been passed through the gray line, and it has been taken out from the other end. And again, back to the other end in a vertical mattress suture. Then a knot is given. And the remaining tail of the suture kept long. the tarsus plate and the orbicularis is sutured layer by layer with by 6-0 Vicryl, and we have to take care to suture the tarsal plate in a lamellar fashion. It should not be a full thickness one. Then the skin is sutured and the tail of the long suture has been tied with the external skin suture to avoid corneal avoid touching the cornea. It is very much important to make that now come to the canaliculi tear. Lower canaliculi is more vulnerable to tear than the upper canaliculi, but when there is upper canaliculi tear is there, it is associated with globe rupture in 20-25% cases. So when you will get a case of a upper canaliculi tear, always have a high suspicion that their globe may be ruptured. The timing of repair of canaliculi tear, the best is less than 6 hours, but 48 hours is standard of care practice. But still, if it is repaired within 1 to 5 days, there is 95% success reported from a large study from China. So even if we are late, we can always try, we should try to repair the canaliculi with a stent in a first go. The choice of stent, bicanalicular stent has a success rate of 60% rate. Monocanalicular, this is the stent of choice. It has a 89-98% success rate. And if both are not available, then 20G silicone rod can be used. And the success of distal tear repair is more than the proximal tear. This is a short video clipping showing the canaliculi tear repair. This is a 10-year-old boy presented with a right eye lower lid canaliculi tear using a fishing hook. First wound exploration is done to identify the cut end. You can see the distal end. It's looking whitish and pearly appearance. First, the puncta is dilated. Then lacrimal probing is done. It is taken out and it is used for the measurement of the required length of the mini monoca stent. The stent is passed through the puncta. The collarette it fixed to the puncta and then it is passed to the distal end just by pushing slowly. Then the pericanalicular tissue is apposed with 6-0 Vicryl interruptive suture. The skin and muscle closed in layer. Okay. And this is the final appearance. This is the 7-year-old boy with a bicycle handle injury, and he had a full upper lid thickness avulsion with canaliculi tear with a total disruption of the caruncle up to the lower lid canaliculi. He has been repaired with a caruncular reposition and both upper and lower lid mini monoca stent. This is the immediate post-op, and this is the post-operative 2 weeks picture. And both the canaliculi is patent after 6 month follow-up. This is a degloving injury. It is actually a very complex type of eyelid laceration along with some other injury also. This 60 years old lady fell into the railway tract and has this degloving injury. In these cases, it's very important to first to identify the devascularized tissue. We have to debride the devascular tissue and the rest of the tissue has to be secured by layer by layer. This is the post-operative 1 week picture. You also may get cases like this, there is a cow horn injury, there is total avulsion and loss of upper lid. Cutler BR reconstruction with auricular cartilage has been done, and this is the final postoperative 1 month picture. Now I'll just touch upon on the orbital fracture. There is usually a history of blunt trauma. The common manifestation are bruising, numbness, bulging, or sunken eye, and AR emphysema. The CT scan of the orbit and brain is the investigation of choice. What are the cases orbital fracture should be urgently referred to the orbit surgeon? These are adult patient with clinical evidence of muscle entrapment and pediatric patient with white eye blowout fracture. This with the symptoms of nausea, vomiting, bradycardia, and syncope. And they should be repaired within 24 hours, 48 hours. This is one of such cases has been done. This is another case. This is my last case, I'll show you. This is one 35 years old male presented with a chronic discharge in the upper eye. He has a history of eyelid repair elsewhere. This is the CT scan showing some soft tissue lesion in the extracranial face. And this is the MRI showing a intense SOL. And on exploration, we found this large wooden foreign body in this patient. So it's very important to do when you're first time you are repairing, you have to examine the wound very nicely. So,
so sorry to interrupt, yes, but we are lagging
this
time.
This is my last slide.
Request you to sum up within a minute.
Yes, this is the last slide, please. Proper evaluation of the globe and adnexus should be done. We should look for foreign body, and laceration of canaliculus must be repaired and stented to prevent tearing after injury. So periocular trauma demands a thoughtful, well-planned approach in order to provide the best outcome and reduce the chances of post-operative complication. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for that extensive talk and some amazing photographs. Periocular trauma is indeed quite a complex subject. I would like Dr. Raman Mittal, sir, to lead the discussion.
Hi, Joyita. It was a wonderful presentation. Joyita, could you like to tell our audience that what if a patient is to be referred to an oculoplastic surgeon? Whether the primary surgeon should repair the canaliculus with whatever means he or she can and then refer, or should they only patch the eye and send it to you even if it's taking a delay of 1 or 2 days?
In my opinion, it should be referred to a person who is expert on this, because the ultimate final outcome will be better who is expertise on this field, because the primary repair time is the best time to get a good result in this thing. So even if you can wait up to 5 days, even a study has shown that up to 5 days, the result is 97%. We can get a patent after some weeks.
Yes, so I guess it's always important that I also wanted to highlight this aspect. Rather than doing a primary repair then, which may not be as great, because once we reopen the wound, sometimes the inflammation or the tissue which have sort of partially repaired, then they the suturing then gets cheese wired later on. It's very difficult to suture, especially if it is deep down into the medial canthus. One quick thing I would like to have from Dr. Anita Sethi or Dr. Grover, sir, like if it's a long, long back tear, a canalicular tear which has been blocked. So now the patient presents to you with a mid canalicular or a proximal canalicular block. Would you like to revisit and open up that area of canaliculus and try to make a fresh canalicular tear and open it? How have you performed and what's your experience about it? Am I clear with my question?
Yeah. So if there's a block, would you like to secondary repair it, or would you like to, I don't think it's going to work if you do a secondary repair. Of course, you evaluate the case and see how proximal or distal the block is. I feel it would be better if the patient is very much bothered with epifora, it might be better to go for a Jones CDCR. Secondary, I mean, depends how long ago and all of that. So if it appears something fresh, which you think you might be able to bypass that, then yes. But if it's something old and there's a lot of epifora, then it might be better to do a different procedure.
Any of the panelists have a different view?
Dr. Raman,
Yeah, Dr. Raman.
I was seeing you unrest, so I thought that you will have a different opinion.
Yeah, in my experience, what I'm doing, I will do a small wedge. If the cut is like, you know, vertical, I will do a small wedge so that I can see the distal and the proximal canaliculus, and then routine lid tear with the mini monocostal. It really works well even after 2-3 months.
Exactly. Actually, this is what I wanted to convey was of late, recently, in last 3-4 years, I've started doing this in old cases also. You know, I try to refashion the wound. I'll create a defect by cutting it on both the ends of the canalicular block and trying to reach the distal end and, you know, repair it like then a new fresh canalicular tear.
Yeah.
If the patient is lucky, it really helps. Otherwise, yes, the options with Dr. Saiti has told, and lacrimal gland Botox injections can come to some rescue to the patient. Thank you, Sameeksha and Joyita. It was wonderful, this presentation. Over to you, Sameeksha.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Now I would like to invite Dr. Anirban Madhuri from Sushruthai Hospital, Kolkata. He will be taking us through some easy steps to tackle eyelid ectropion and entropion. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, Sameeksha, I'm sorry. I had accidentally entered the wrong room and I was waiting there. I couldn't understand why I couldn't see all of you. And thanks to Raman, I'm back. So I'll quickly run you through this short presentation. I hope it's short. And this is something all of you know, I mean, the anatomy, but basically what keeps the eyelids in position. So this is more important for the lower lid simply because the lower lid can hang down because of gravity. So it is the pull of the capsular palpebral fascia of the lower lid retractors, the tautness of the canthal tendons, which are supporting the tarsal plate against the globe, and the interplay between the two lamella, the posterior and the anterior. And this decides whether you end up having a malposition, which is either an entropion or an ectropion. Let's look at entropion, which is an inward rotation of the eyelid margin. These are the common four types. The commonest have been highlighted, the involution and the cicatrician. So this is a patient who has involutional, while this child has cicatrician, and we'll show you a little more about this later. But what causes involution entropion? Basically, there is a laxity or a dehiscence of the lower lid retractors. There is a horizontal eyelid laxity either because of the canthal tendons or the tarsal plate, and overriding of the preseptal orbicularis on the pre-tarsal. And these mechanisms are important so that we understand how are we going to address them. So when you examine a patient, one of the tests that you can do is a pinch test or a lid distraction test, where you pull the eyelid away from the globe. And if you can move it 8 to 10 millimeters or more, then there is definitely a horizontal lid laxity. Along with a snapback test, my video is not running, but basically you pull the lid down and you let it go. And if it recovers within a blink, you have a normal eyelid tone. Otherwise, there would be laxity. And the information is important because whether you're going to just correct the entropion or would you also correct the horizontal lid laxity, that decision would come from there. Now, there are lots of ways of treating lower lid entropion of involutional origin. But what we'll do is we'll talk about just two procedures. And the reason is because these two procedures seem to be able to tackle most of our problems. Okay. So one is the Jones procedure, where you do an anatomical reattachment of the capsular palpebral fascia as well as correct the overriding of the orbicularis muscles. And if you have an horizontal lid laxity, you combine that with a lateral tarsal strip procedure. Let's go to a video of the surgery. This is a surgery that most of us practice, and we would encourage more of our colleagues to take up this. It's a fairly simple surgery if you understand the anatomy. So we've given lid traction sutures, and this incision is at the lower border of the tarsus here, about 4 millimeters from the lid margin. The idea is that we cut through the orbicularis between the preseptal and the pretarsal orbicularis, and then do a dissection in the suborbicularis plane to expose the orbital septum here. Now, what we are actually looking for is under the orbital septum, you would either find that the capsular palpebral fascia has separated or dehesed from the tarsal lower tarsal border, or it has become lax. So what we're doing is cutting the orbital septum here. You can do it with scissors as well. You don't need fancy instruments like this. But basically, under this, under the pre-epineurotic fat, is where we look. This is where we have the dehisced structure. So we are holding the structure, we are dissecting the fat away from there to expose it. And one of the ways of testing is, if you ask the patient to look down on table, you will feel a tug on the forceps through which you're holding. So this patient, we are also going to combine this with a lateral tarsal strip. We've done a lateral canthotomy and we're doing an inferior cantholysis now to separate the lid out. And then we'll separate this section completely so that we know how much of laxity we need to correct. And this is what we have, a lot of laxity. We are going to remove the redundant part of the lid, but we'll keep the tarsal strip. So this is the entire idea, that you create a tarsal strip which will reattach to the lateral wall of the orbit. And you remove the anterior lamina here, also remove the conjunctiva at the lid margin as well as the posterior conjunctiva. In this case, we are using a monopolar cautery to just burn it off. And then you expose the lateral orbital rim. The idea is that you make your attachment as close to the Whitnall's ligament, Whitnall's tubercle as possible. So we have removed the redundant part of the lateral tarsal strip, and now we'll pass the suture that I'm using here is a braided polyester. Now you can also use proline or you can use Vicryl, but braided polyester has very good knotting properties and again is a strong as well as a permanent suture. So over the years, I have shifted to this material. This is a 5-0 braided polyester. And when you put this suture through the periosteum at the lateral orbital rim, you get nice correction of the horizontal lid laxity. So once you've done that, we can go back to doing the Jones procedure. And here what we're doing is we are passing these correcting sutures through the skin orbicularis, through the dehisced or loose lower lid retractors here, then through the tarsal plate, the lower border, and again the orbicularis and skin. You can also do a direct suture of the CPF to the tarsal plate, but I find that this works better in my hands because here, if required, I can remove the sutures earlier in case I end up getting a little bit of overcorrection. So you pass three such correcting sutures through the CPF, and then you close the orbicularis and the skin. And finally, after you've closed the skin, is when you actually tie these correcting sutures. So this is completion of the skin closure. And now you do the correction. So the purpose of correction here would be just to get the lid margin at the right place. We don't want to overcorrect in a Jones procedure. So gently tie these sutures, you've achieved the anatomical reattachment of the CPF. And once you've done this, your surgery is over. Okay, so this is the same patient after correction. We corrected the horizontal lid laxity as well because we combined this with the LTS. Now let's look at the other situation. Cicatricial entropion is when you have scarring of the conjunctiva, the posterior lamella, and this is often seen in the upper lid in patients with trachoma, which we used to see when we worked in North India. And in both the lids, in patients who have cicatrizing disease like Stevens-Johnson syndrome or ocular pemphigoid. Now, again, there are several techniques of treating these conditions, but we'll stick to, again, one which works well for us, which is the tarsal fracture and lid margin rotation. And we'll quickly go through the video. How much time do we have? 5 minutes, okay. So again, you evert the lid and you make an incision at the scar. It's a full thickness incision through the tarsal plate without disturbing the orbicularis and the skin, which is why we call it the tarsal fracture. And once you've liberated this segment, we just evert it using sutures so that you end up with a new lid margin. So this lid margin, which is scarred, which was irritating the ocular surface, would be moved from the ocular surface. So you give relaxing incision at both ends of your tarsal fracture so that you can rotate the lid margin away from the ocular surface. I'm just completing the dissection with scissors so that I'm sure that I've done a full thickness incision. You can see the orbicularis below. Once you've achieved that, that is when you put your correcting suture. So I'm passing this to the anterior face of the tarsal plate here. If you have double arm sutures, that would be nice. And we give three or four such correcting sutures, which work like horizontal matrix sutures along the lid margin. This suture emerges just a little above the lash line on the skin surface. Okay, so once you've done this, you just tie these sutures tightly so that you achieve an overcorrection. In this particular surgery, you aim for an overcorrection. Okay. We'll skip congenital in the interest of time. There are different conditions. You just need to identify them correctly and then treat them. Let's go to ectropion quickly. So this is where you have an outward rotation or eversion of the lid margin. Again, several types. The common ones being involutional, cicatricial, or paralytic. And they are treated differently. So let's look at involution ectropion. The basic mechanisms are the same as for entropion, except that the lid turns outwards. So this is a patient who has mild ectropion, more severe. This is a typical tarsal ectropion where the entire tarsal surface is exposed and often becomes inflamed. If you have just a medial ectropion where you have an eversion of the punctum, you can treat that by doing a diamond excision followed by inverting sutures here. While more extensive one would be treated differently. So there used to be this historical surgery which didn't work well for me, but let's look at the other way of doing it. Do a horizontal lid tightening, the LTS, and the Jones. So the same surgery that we did for entropion works in LTS. The difference is we add inverting sutures, which go from close to the tarsal plate to further down along the lid margin. And this is how it works. So this is a patient who's had a Jones plus LTS along with inverting sutures. So this is a patient with bilateral mild ectropion, where you see that there is rounding of the tarsal, the lateral canthus here. So this patient actually had a detachment of the lateral canthal tendons on both sides. And all we did was, for this patient, just an LTS, a lateral tarsal strip procedure. Okay, in facial palsy, the mechanism is slightly different, but how will you tackle it? Here again, what would work is a lateral tarsal strip. Here you exaggerate the lift of the lateral canthal tendon along with a medial canthoplasty or a medial canthal tendon tightening. I'll just show you a picture. So this is a patient who undergone medial canthoplasty, hasn't worked so great. And then we've done a medial canthoplasty here. So this is the last slide that I have, a patient who has a cicatricial ectropion because of scarring of this anterior lamella. So you just excise the scar and we put a full thickness graft. This patient also had an ophthalmic socket and we took care of that at the same time. So basically what we've covered is the different types of ectropion and entropion, as well as the mechanisms underlying these problems. And just a few surgeries are all you need in your armamentarium to be able to tackle these cases instead of trying to learn an entire range of surgeries. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sameeksha, I'm just going to interrupt here. Dr. Fairooz here. We have to be keeping up the time.
Yes, doctor.
All right, yeah, and probably we can take the discussion
in the interest of the session
rather than inserting it in between. That might help.
Sure, ma'am. So I would now like to invite Dr. Mohammad Shahid Alam from Kolkata again. He will be taking us through some good, bad, and ugly eyelid swellings. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes.
I request you to please start screen sharing.
Are my slides visible?
Started screen sharing.
Started screen sharing.
Not edge.
Not, yes, yeah. Sir, visible.
Yes, sir, we can see them.
So can we start?
Yes,
sir.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. At the outset, I'd like to thank AIS Scientific Committee, especially Dr. Fergus, for giving me this opportunity. I'll be talking on eyelid swellings, good, bad, and ugly. So we'll just start with a case. So it's a 9-year-old girl presented with a large eyelid swelling, which had been there for the past 1 month. There was no history of pain, fever, or any trauma. And on palpation, the swelling was fluctuant. So we suspected an eyelid abscess. And we went ahead and drained it and sent the sample for microbiological evaluation. But to our surprise, within a week, the swelling recurred, and it is the picture at the time of recurrence. So at this time, we thought of getting an imaging done, and this is the MRI picture, which shows T2 hyperintense mass in the preceptal region of the lower eyelid with some areas of hypointensity. So this is the case with which we'll start, and the final diagnosis and management, I will talk once my presentation is over. So just to... I'll give you a brief outline of the common causes of eyelid swellings that we routinely come across in our OPD. And then I will present some masquerading conditions. So eyelid swellings they form a broad category, and the differential diagnosis is extensive. They can range from simple dermatosis to complex eyelid tumors. And their key presenting features can lead us to a diagnosis. So for each case, we should listen to the history properly. We should observe the lesions very carefully for the telltale signs. And we should always go ahead and palpate the lesion to look whether to see whether the temperature is raised and to see for the consistency of the mass. So the most common lesions that we will routinely come across as eyelid swellings in our OPD are hodulum, both externum and internum, which are the infections of the glands of Zeiss and Meibomian glands respectively. As you can see in this present case, it's a case of internal hodulum, which has developed into a lid abscess, and it has ruptured on its own with a small pus point. And these internal hodulum, when they heal, sometimes they form into calesion, as you can see in this picture. This calesion can be single, multiple, it can involve one lid and both lids. They are most commonly seen in the upper eyelids because of the numerous meibomian glands present in the upper eyelid. So the management is simple. It's just patient needs an incision and curettage. And in cases where there is diffuse thickening, you can also try intralesional triamcinolone. Of course, eyelid hygiene has to be prescribed for the patient. Now, preceptal cellulitis is a common condition where children will present with eyelid swellings. This condition has to be differentiated from orbital cellulitis, where apart from lid swelling, the patient also presents with proptosis, extraocular motility restriction. And in some cases where the proptosis is severe, you can also have signs of optic nerve involvement in the form of sluggish pupillary reaction and an RAPD. So obviously, in all these cases, you should look for the source of infection, which is most commonly a hodulum or an eyelid infection. The infection can spread from the sinuses. So in this case where of preceptal cellulitis, you should start the patient on a course of empirical broad spectrum antibiotics, and the patient has to be under close follow up. Now this is another case of preceptal cellulitis. As you can see, there is a swelling and erythema of the left upper eyelid. But if you look closely, there is also an induration and crusting seen in the area of lacrimal sac region. So it's a case of nasolacrimal duct obstruction. The preceptal cellulitis is secondary to NLDO. So you should always look for the cause of preceptal cellulitis. Now this is another case of preceptal cellulitis. So what is the striking feature here? The striking feature here is the bilateral involvement of the patient. You can see the lids are swollen bilaterally. So whenever there is bilateral involvement, you should look for systemic involvement. You see the face of this patient is it appears quite oily and shiny. So we sought for a dermatologist's opinion in this case, and it turned out to be a case of acne rosacea, and patient was subsequently managed. Now preceptal cellulitis can sometimes lead into orbital lid abscesses. So they present as eyelid swellings, eyelid masses, which will be fluctuant on palpation. So that's why a palpation is very important. So these lid abscesses will be fluctuant, and they should be drained by incision and drainage immediately. And the material should be sent for microbiological evaluation. This is another case where a child has a huge lid abscess. he was also taken up for incision and drainage, and this is the post-operative picture. Here, the microbiology was suggestive of methicillin-resistant Staph aureus. So, MRSA is a growing concern in all these patients, and whenever the abscess is huge, it's atypical, there is no involvement of sinuses, we should always think of MRSA. This particular patient was later started on oral linezolid. Now, this is another case where the patient has presented with right upper eyelid swelling, and you can see the areas of crusting in the lateral canthal and the medial canthal area. So, now this is just half of the story. Now, when you look the patient carefully, you can see the crusting is also seen in the distribution of trigeminal nerve along the forehead and the temporal region. So, it's a patient, it's a diabetic patient. It's a case of herpes zoster ophthalmicus. All these cases, in all these patients, we should rule out corneal involvement and anti-chamber involvement, and a dermatologist's opinion should be taken to start on proper dosage and duration of oral cyclovir. So, as compared to herpes zoster ophthalmicus, herpes simplex, they generally affect a younger group of patients. Patients are non-diabetic. And here we see crops of small vesicular lesions distributed in a unilateral fashion, as you can see in this case. Now, trauma is another important cause of eyelid swelling. In the setting of trauma, the causes for eyelid swelling can be both preceptal or metal cellulitis. They can be a formation of eyelid hematoma or an impacted foreign body. So in this case here, you can see there was a huge eyelid swelling, and patient could not open his eyes properly also. There was chemosis also. So a CT scan was done which showed presence of eyelid hematoma. So the patient was started on a short course of oral steroid and ice compresses followed by hot fomentation. And now you can see this picture that the eyelid swelling has nicely resolved. So important take-home message in cases of trauma is that all these patients should undergo a CT scan to rule out any orbital fracture, a foreign body, or other orbital pathologies. Blepharitis is another common condition which presents with eyelid swelling in our OPD. This is a young female who was a diabetic, had another systemic issues. You can see here the patient had started with a squamous blepharitis, which is now converted into an ulcerative blepharitis. So this particular case was managed with topical antibiotic ointment drops and a course of oral doxycycline. Dermatitis can be both allergic and contact dermatitis. Allergic dermatitis, if we are suspecting allergic dermatitis, we should ask history of exposure with the patient, and the typical appearance will be swelling with a puckered on appearance, as you can see in this case. So this is a case of allergic dermatitis, and the patient had developed this dermatitis secondary to anti-glaucoma medication, and this is post-treatment. As you can see that the swelling has nicely resolved. So we should, in cases of allergic dermatitis, the mainstay of management is steroid ointment. Of course, in cases where there is history of anti-glaucoma medication, we can skip steroid and we can start the patient on tacrolimus. Thyroid eye disease is another common condition which will present with eyelid swelling. Of course, there will be other signs like proptosis, lid diffraction, and depending upon the activity of the disease, there will be present of congestion or optic neuropathy. Eyelid fistulas. These are here the patient will present with a lower eyelid swelling. So fistulas are basically they are also called as malar mounds, and they are collection of fluids in the lower eyelid secondary to attenuated orbicularis and skin in older age patient. And a malfunctioning of lymphatics is suspected in these cases. Management is very challenging and difficult. Different treatment modalities in the form of laser resurfacing and surgery have been tried for these patients. So fistulas should be differentiated from lower eye from fat prolapse, which mimics fistulas. But here, the patient in fat prolapse, the three eyelid fat bags which are there, which are present in the lower eyelid, they actually prolapse out secondary to dehiscence. And for differentiating it from fistulas, we should ask the patient to look up and look down. Fat prolapse, they actually get more pronounced when the patient look up, and they disappear when they look down, which doesn't happen with the cases of fistulas. So the tumors is another broad category which can present with eyelid swellings. Of course, I cannot present all of the cases of tumors. So just to give you a brief highlight, common benign tumors that we will see in our OPD are like epidermoid cysts, dermal nevus, hydrocystoma, which can be both ecrine and apocrine, and of course, eyelid neurofibroma. So these are the common benign eyelid tumors that you will see in routinely in your OPD, which will present as eyelid lumps. The most three common malignant tumors which will present in our OPD are sebaceous gland carcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, and squamous cell cell carcinoma. Of course, the management is out of the scope of this presentation. So this was, in brief, the common causes of eyelid swellings. So just to present with some masquerades that can present with a common condition, but finally they come out to be something else. So this is a young female who had a history of incision and keratosis for calesion twice, and he had presented with swelling again. As you can see, this is not a typical appearance of a calesion. The swelling is irregular, it's the area is rough, and it's extending up to the tarsal plate. So we had a doubt of sebaceous gland carcinoma. We took an incisional biopsy. It turned out to be sebaceous gland carcinoma, and the patient had ultimately had to be undergo wide excision of the mass.
So it was Dr. Alam, could you sum up, please? Sorry, we are running short of time. Can you sum up, please?
Yeah, yeah. So just to start, tell about the case from where we had started. So this the child was presented with lower eyelid swelling, and here we suspected lymphangioma, so we went ahead and we completely debrided the mass. And to our surprise, on histopathology, we saw sporangia in multiple stages of maturation. So it was actually a case of eyelid rhinosporidiosis. So this is the post-operative picture. So it's a case of eyelid rhinosporidiosis, which presented as an eyelid abscess. So to conclude, eyelid swellings are diverse. Their presentation is actually the clue to the diagnosis. Most are benign and treatable. And whether they are good, bad, and ugly depends upon our diagnostic acumen and management. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for those comprehensive talk and some amazing cases. I would now like to invite Dr. Rituja Thomas from Vision Eye Center, New Delhi, to take us through an interesting case.
Thanks, Dr. Sameeksha, and thank you to Dr. Fairuz and the organizing team for having me today. Honored to be here. So I'll just really be quickly going through this case, a very simple case, but important to cover as a part of our eyelid session. So we had a 27-year-old gentleman who complained of drooping of his eyelids and a large gap between both his eyes. Ever since he was a kid. So he had, if you notice, a shortened vertical and horizontal palpable fissure, telecanthus, epicanthus inversus, and ptosis with an absent eyelid crease. We took some measurements for him. So the interpupillary distance was 60 millimeters. The intermedial canthal distance was 42 millimeters. And we'll come to the significance of this soon. The vertical palpable fissure was also measured. He had a levator action of 4 millimeters, frontalis overaction. And we also looked at the lateral limbus to lateral canthus measurement and the medial limbus to medial canthus measurement. His unaided vision was 6-6 in both eyes. The ptosis probably didn't cover the visual axis when he was younger, so he developed good vision. And the rest of his ocular examination was normal. So he came to us mainly for cosmesis and getting his eyes to look slightly more normal. So in an adult, cosmesis is probably the indication for surgery in blepharophimosis. But in children, they end up needing surgery for the ptosis and things like that, especially when it obscures the visual axis. So there it is more of a therapeutic indication. So our patient underwent surgery in two stages. So one was the correction of the epicanthus and telecanthus, and that's the stage which I'm going to cover, as the ptosis part has already been covered earlier. So the first stage, that is the Y to V plasty with transnasal wiring. Now, how did we come to this measurement of 6 millimeters? So first, we select what are the markings to be done. So the central marking is done first, which is the midpoint of both the medial canthi. Now the length. So the vertical aspect of the Y, that is calculated by taking the actual intermedial canthal distance minus the desired intermedial canthal distance, which is half of the IPD, and then dividing it by 2. So when we measure this 6 mm, it's a little medial to the medial canthus that we see, so that because we pull the sort of eyelid medially, because the epicanthus sort of covers the actual medial canthus, and then we take the measurement. Following this, the nose is packed after the patient is under. The nose is packed on both sides. The incision is opened. A good dissection is carried out to expose the medial palpable ligament. And the part of the bone there is dissected and punched. And a good wide opening is made. So once the medial palpable ligament is isolated, a wire roughly about 26 gauge, this is slightly bigger here, but ideally 26 gauge of wire is passed through the medial palpable ligament. And then with the needle, it is passed across where the both the sides bony opening is made, across to the other side. And the wire is pulled through and the other medial palpable ligament is engaged. The two ends are tied once the medial palpable ligament of one side is pulled through to the other side and the ends are cut with a wire cutter. Now, when this is sort of tightened, we should make sure that there is good symmetry on both the sides. So this is basically just a rough overview, representative video of what was done. So the medial palpable ligament on one side is being engaged. And then this is pulled through after creating the bony windows to the other side with the help of a long needle. And the other side medial palpable ligament is engaged. After this, these two ends are tied once both the ends have come to one side. And then the incision is closed. Once we confirm that there is a good symmetry on both the sides. Good care is taken to make sure that there is no injury to the canaliculi. So this, if you notice, there is a good deep correction of the medial canthus, which gives a more natural appearance. And yes, epiphora can sometimes occur, but it's usually transient if the dissection and the bony openings are carried out carefully. So this is the patient's appearance at 1 week post-operative. This is a little bit of a side view to show how the medial canthus has sort of gone deeper, like so. So the next stage is carried out after 6 months and the surgery of choice is a bilateral facial artery sling that I will not be covering. So in short, blepharophimosis is rare. It's bilateral, it's autosomal dominant. It is commoner in males and usually presents with everything that we mentioned along with the lateral ectropion at times. And it can be managed either in a single stage or two stage with the following procedures. That is a Mastardet Z plasty or a Y to V plasty along with medial palpable ligament tucking or a transnasal wiring and sometimes a lateral canthoplasty if there is not a good shape already. After this, a bilateral facial artery sling is done. And usually a good correction is achieved. However, the ptosis correction is also sometimes cosmetically limited by the inherent abnormalities of the blepharophimosis syndrome. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for taking us through the detailed management of this BPS syndrome. In the interest of time, I will have to conclude this session, but we had a very good session. I would like to thank our chairpersons, Dr. Anita Sethi and Dr. Raman Mittal, and our convener, Dr. Marian Pauly, for putting this together, for Dr. Fairuz for putting this together and giving us this opportunity, and all our speakers, Dr. Anitan Badali, Dr. Ashok Grover, Dr. Joyita Das, Dr. Mohammad Shahzadam and Dr. Vishwacharya. Thank you so much. Over to Dr. Ishan Acharya for the next session.